Potholes and Penguins with Barry and Trimby.
Barry, have you ever been on stage and gone to remove your microphone from the stand and there's been a little bit of initial friction, and then once that friction gives way, you dunt yourself in the face of the microphone?
I don't think so. I'm not one for taking off the mic off the stand and fanning about with it. I usually keep it where it is. Back in the day when we used to play in pubs, when people were allowed to get close enough to touch you, which was awful. They would, if it was a heaving bar and one of them would be pushing, shoving, and then someone would fall and maybe trip over the speaker, which is on the ground in front of me. It's called a monitor, which allows me to hear my own vocal, which is a death trap for anyone who doesn't see it. And that's usually why you have a stage, that so people can't fall over these fucking things. But they trip over that and grab the microphone stand to balance themselves, and then that would end up whacking me in the face because I'd be singing. I get a microphone in the lip.
It's like, I could do a lot of damage.
Yeah, yeah, fucking teeth. Yeah, your teeth would come out, like, and they've no idea. Like, they're so pissed. Remember that time we were in Abu Dhabi a few years ago, and they were so bananas because they'd had a fucking one of those
brunches
where they'd be drinking all day, and this one fell over and grabbed the mic and smashed my teeth, and then continued to try and pull herself up off the ground by holding onto the mic and pulling the wire off.
I'd say that's happened to Shane McGowan a few times. That's why he looks like such a state. Plenty of microphone stand collisions.
Would have just been doing it to himself.
He's just been beaten to death with microphone stands.
Yeah. So I was watching the game, right?
Yes. Are we going to hear? I'm looking forward to. Well, on the first viewing, I thought this, but on the second viewing,
I'll get to that later. When I first saw Johnny Sexton coming out with the new haircut, I was like, "Oh, yes, he's gone full Britney Spears on us. He's losing, losing his mind."
Why is he carrying an umbrella onto the pitch?
Johnny's having a fucking breakdown. It was going to be an intervention. I was so desperate for a chink in their armour that I was like, yes, Sexton's having a meltdown. He's after shaving his head at home. Just
yeah, he went home. He walked home in a red leather onesie. Oops.
Yeah, no, that was the only probably thing that was similar to Britney Spears, is the fact that he was probably driving home going, oops, we did it again. We played with your heart, but you lost in the end. Oh, Munster, Munster, oops, you thought that you won.
Sting that, Dermy.
It came from above. You wasn't finished yet. Something like that.
Yeah.
But I wish it was more like he had a nervous breakdown, and then, like, do you know the way Britney Spears hashtag Free Britney, where she's her father and his lawyer control her finances and may basically own her, and they make her do all this. This is why there was a Free Britney campaign last year, that everyone was like, we need to get her out of this contract. I wish it was Free Johnny and the IRFU controlled him and they wouldn't let him retire. So it's a hashtag Free Johnny. And they keep wheeling him out in the Aviva every week, and because there's no other out halves in the world in Ireland. They keep making him play, and he's just like, I just want to retire with my kids. I could see that Six Nations now would come out in a sexy schoolgirl outfit with a snake around him. Around his neck. We'll have to start a campaign outside, get a load of penguins outside. No.
Just holding up signs saying Free Johnnies. It'd just be like inside New UL for Sexual Health Awareness Week.
Free Johnnies. Yeah. There are a few taking advantage. I'm telling you, lads. That's what it's like. He just wants to retire with his loads of money and his kids, and shave his head and sing his songs. What was her first song? Kick it, Johnny, one more time. Yeah. Anyway. There's loads to talk about in that game.
Mm-hmm.
There. We'll get into it in the part
two. Is it going to overflow into part one?
No, we'll come back to it in part two. I'm happy enough to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We could be, we're lucky to be here, Dermy. We could be paying tribute to our fallen comrade.
Oh, yeah. That was a bit of a touch and go a week there, Letts.
Yeah. So I must explain to, firstly, apologies to our Patreon members because there was no weekly pothole this week because I had an illness, non-COVID related illness. It was...
And no, you can't get your money back.
The fiver is ours. As I open a can, it was a heart-related illness.
What are you drinking there?
Love is here.
Love is here. I'm on an American pale ale.
Lovely. This is delicious.
Boundary
Brewery. Fantastic beer.
.coop/shop. Use the discount code WillAddison.
I'm never surprised you how delicious those beers are.
Oh, every time. Go on.
So will I explain to you what happened to me? Yes. Non-COVID related. I woke up last weekend and I was feeling pressure across my chest. Wasn't feeling great. Sunday was a little bit worse. Monday, I was feeling very restricted and very specifically on the left side where your heart is located. Can't be a heart. So I was there. Rang the doctor and the doctor said, go to the hospital. And get yourself checked, get your bloods done, get a right C into it. And I was like, I don't want to go to the hospital. That's where they all are.
That's where they keep the big scary thing.
Yeah. And it's mental, apparently. So, but at the same time, I don't want to be that lad that doesn't go to the hospital. And then people are going, ah, geez, he looked very healthy. But unfortunately, no, he is no more. So I said, fuck it, I'll go. And I went to the hospital and they said... Yeah, sit down there. We'll get your bloods done. This is about lunchtime. And they said, we'll get your bloods done and we'll check you and you'll be grand. And we'll wait for you to see the cardiologist who's going to come around and have to do a check in you as well. So I did the bloods and then I just chilled out for hours. And then at 7 o'clock, they said, okay, the cardiologist isn't here yet. So you're going to have to stay the night and see him tomorrow. And then I was like, oh, no. So they brought me into A&E. Now.
Okay. Are we going to do a recreation here?
it was so... Do you know what? People on our Facebook page have been saying, was he abducted by aliens?
Yeah.
Or did he have something to do with his cholesterol? And it was a little bit of both. It could well have been abducted by aliens because that's what the A&E in the University Hospital Limerick looks like. It's like... the sick bay in the Star Trek Enterprise. And I know we're laughing at this, but it's mental.
Yeah.
So we have to laugh at it a little bit, but it is fucking terrifying. So you bring in and they say, right, you're in for tonight. I was like, I don't want to be in for tonight. No, we're doing your bloods now. Sit over in that trolley there. And they're all masked up to the nines. You can't see anyone. They're all low. And then there's just 12 rooms in the middle of A&E. I haven't been to A&E since I played rugby. So 10 years plus. It's revamped. Very futuristic. So they've got 12 rooms, the numbers above them, and then they're sliding doors for each room to get into, very much like Star Trek. So you press the button and then behind each door is one bed because everyone in there, each room has COVID. So people who have COVID are in the room and in each room, just one room each, and then everyone else who doesn't have COVID and is there for something else is lying on a trolley in the A&E. And then you've all the staff going around the place head to toe.
Yeah.
Can't really see much that's going on, just coming over talking to you. And again, no one's really speaking because everyone's so busy and so up the walls.
Most people are fluent in the Star Trek language.
So it feels like there's no communication. So again, you feel almost like you've been abducted. And I was listening to a podcast at the time, which was a terrible idea, about the most famous alien abduction ever in history, which is a guy called Travis Watson, I think was his name. He was on Joe Rogan the other day and he was abducted in 1975, apparently, by a load of aliens in Arizona. And it was very similar to what I was seeing, was what he was describing. But it wasn't, it was just a hospital. so they left me there for the night and I was watching normal people just sitting on the bed. And it was anything but normal, lads.
Just pitching a tent.
Yeah. I was afraid of that. Anyone looking over my shoulder is just thinking I'm watching.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Porn on my laptop in the middle of A&E with a boner.
Why does that patient have a boner?
Trust me, it's the last place you're going to get a boner.
How is he getting a boner? This place is not sexy in the slightest.
He just loves Star Trek.
I just love COVID.
Aliens and Star Trek.
It's the gowns.
That one thinks he's an alien.
I'd love to be, that's my fantasy, is to be abducted. And they do sexual things to me.
So in for the night then.
Do you know what the one, a good thing was that because of my recent change in fashion,
yeah,
I was wearing a suit and my trench coat jacket,
yeah,
that you would normally only wear at funerals, but now I wear it everywhere, and they didn't give me a blanket, so at least I had that as and now I didn't ask for a blanket because I didn't want to talk to anyone for the whole night because they're so busy and wound up in there that I didn't want to talk to anyone. But fuck, man, it's scary.
Yeah.
It is so, like, you think they're, you hear they're superheroes and all this, but they're not superheroes. They're real people. They're just not, they are normal people. Funnily enough, just like the show, suggesting they're all normal people. They're not out of this world people. They are just regular people who have to go in there every day and do this.
Yeah.
For months, a whole year.
Yeah.
And treat people who are, there was people in their bananas drunk, langers, like coming in. Obviously, maybe people are having trouble at home and coming in. I don't know what circumstances are where people coming in drunk, but getting rude and aggressive and throughout the night. And then you've these staff in there, like doctors, nurses, even receptionists, even caterers who just.
So COVID aside, it's just bananas in general, is what you're saying.
I don't know. This is 100% related to COVID, I'd imagine. Everyone is more highly strung, and then they're so understaffed that the facilities are so small that it was in the paper today, they had the Independent were invited into the UCH on Sunday last week in Limerick to just see how bad it is. And they were mostly in the ICU, and they were describing just how overrun it was and how strapped for staff they are. And especially ICU nurses are in massive, there's a lack of them.
Has your opinion, like an estimation of like what it's like to be a nurse or a doctor right now, gone through the roof with, like, they are pretty fearless, or it's mad to be having to deal with that on a daily occurrence?
I didn't think, you know, we all know that anyway.
Yeah.
I suppose you just get to see it. It's just a newfound
experience, and is different than people talking about.
Maybe. I just can't believe they have to do that every day and still just get on with it. And it's mad. I know we're doing everything we can to, at the moment, to make it easier for them, but scary place. And they were unbelievably sound at the end of the day. It got me sorted. I'll be seeing a cardiologist in the next few weeks. I'm grand. Back to me personally, I'm fine. I'll be grand. It was just, they couldn't explain what it was. I'm getting a CT angiogram of my heart to see where, if there's any blockages in my arteries or veins. I'm on a bit of medication. I'll be fine. They said, continue on. Go for your runs. Do your meditation. Keep fasting.
Don't meditate. Have you been meditating? Whatever you do.
Keep wearing your suits. I'm adding a sixth. I'm selling dermy.
Wearing your suits, you weirdo. Keep doing all your five weird things.
Cutting off the blood pressure to your heart.
My top button is quite tight, actually. I'm going to open this. Maybe that's what it was. It was his top button all along.
Yeah, we did. Like, it was our WhatsApp had an interesting tone, because I kept I suppose it was very serious, or it had the potential to be very serious, but you know, yeah. My initial reaction is to like take the piss out of the situation, and then I really wanted Barry to know that I genuinely do care though. Like, I was actually worried that if Barry dies and they look back through his WhatsApps, it's just me like slagging him in the last week of his life.
Toughen up. That's what you want though. You know, just, I know it's such a cliche, but you just don't want to be treated any differently. My sister rang me and she's like, Hey, Bab. How are you? I said, stop talking to me. Fucking something wrong with me. I'm grand. So I was downplaying everything. So, but yeah, that is a funny side. You have to do more work, just trying to placate your, is that the right word? Your family and friends. Is that the word? To just
placate.
Is that the word? No. What's the word I'm thinking of?
Plamas.
Plamas or
Plamas O'Leary.
Just stop them worrying.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, okay. You have to manage them. I used to, if I ever got I remember one time I got a nasty injury. I was getting kind of carried off, and it was always, I'm always worried about Anna and my mom, what they would think. And I remember giving them like, you know, the way you get lads like that coming off on a stretcher, giving it that. Mm. But I just think you look like you're even more out of it. Like, what is he doing? He's in a bad way.
End up giving your mom and Anna the middle finger up. Fuck you, turkey.
Wanker.
I did think,
just give one of those, do you know the way you can do that? Wrist clip thing.
Oh, the clip thing, yeah.
That?
Yeah.
Oh, for sure. Bra.
Do one of them instead.
I wondered I wondered what, you know, we've been talking recently about how you have a mentoring role on myself, and I assume had a significant influence on Dermy and a lot of our penguins. So we're down a mentor. So I wondered, you know, what influence that you would have, like a lasting influence on me, and how I would change my life to kind of long term pay tribute. And I thought of a few things. First of all, I would get a nose ring, straight up. First up, and then you know, and I'm gonna have those inevitable.
I will leave you my nose ring. Okay?
No, you're all right. Give it to an open casket. Yoink! I'll take that.
Did you just take his nose ring? Oh, it's tough. I can't get it out.
I would start wearing two pairs of socks always, every day.
Every day,
even when it's roasting. Mm-hmm. And I would open a karate dojo called Barry Do.
I'm used as a karate.
I know, but you're my Mr. Miyagi, and
but so it wouldn't be normal karate stuff you'd be doing in there.
No, it'd be weird stuff. It would be all the weird stuff that you do. Those would be like the five pillars of the Barry Do.
The tenets of Barry Do.
Yes. Okay,
yeah.
I love it.
So that's
what's your next thing you're adding to your Barry Do?
I want to add a sixth thing that everyone should do every day is watch the Castletown Donkey Derby. I'm sure you've seen this before. Have you seen this before, Jimmy?
No.
What's this? It's Donkey Derby in the early 90s in Castletown, which I think is near enough to. Where's that near enough to Abbeyfield or something like
that?
That's
West Limerick for sure. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, West Limerick, and it's a derby involving people riding donkeys around the field. And it unfolds just absolutely sensationally what happens in it. One donkey tries to ride another donkey while two children are on their backs. And there's a fella commentating on it who is my hero. And I just think that is a daily dose of that for the next 2 months. You can't get enough of it.
No, I highly, highly agree.
Yeah. So after this, anyone who's listening, just go home, watch the Donkey Derby. Grant.
Mm-hmm. Harry Mull and Percy are fighting out, and they're at the second last spin. And here comes Marcelli and Cian. And Cian has a job keeping Marcelli out of the bushes. She's still mad to bring Cian into the bushes. And there goes Harry Mull. Harry Mull and Percy are. And Harry Mull, and what's it trying to get up now? And Harry Mull is one.
And I'm thank you for the mentoring thing. A few people have gotten on to me during the week saying that, it was such a beautiful thing to say, and I didn't acknowledge it. All I wanted to do was see how much I could get your wife to pay me for it. You have also that kind of positive influence on me, whereas I more so that you can't take anything seriously, as you just alluded to, by not being able to take the fact that I may have been dying seriously. And that is your last thing.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it's my cross to bear.
Yeah, so that's all I've got for you. Go on, give us the this week's silly Trimbies Suey Way to Beat.
It's Trimby's silly little bit.
Well, it's the day after the Interpros, the night before, and it's a snow day. The response from the players in red and blue when waking up to snow on the ground may well serve to demonstrate the difference of mindset due to last night's results. Leinster players jump out of bed excitedly and run to the window, immediately forgetting about the physical toll put on their bodies the night before. An official team snowball fight has been arranged. The players are to meet at Stevens Green at 11 a.m. They frolic, they laugh. Their hearts are so full of the pure joy and innocent fun of a snow day. The lads think they're in a Wham music video. Until Johnny brings them into a huddle and ruins the buzz a little bit by demanding more detail and accuracy with their snowmen. Munster players, by contrast, all run out of oil overnight and wake up freezing to their wives complaining that they knew this would happen. Ben Healy stares at himself in the mirror for 20 minutes, shaking his head, then cuts his own hair in a tantrum. Tagburn has another flashback to his Rocky mountaintop moment, Drago, and then he bursts into tears. Pete O'Mahony usually goes for a walk in the garden, but he's tormented that the frost is damaging his hostas. And CJ wakes up tied to the bed by his wife, like Paul Sheldon in Misery. I'm your number one fan. No snowballs for you today, CJ. The Munster hangover is going to last a few weeks.
Very good.
Nice one.
Very visual.
Mm.
I enjoyed that.
Did you notice Tagburn? We mentioned this last week against Connacht. He got animated.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then he got animated last night as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very unlike him.
Mm. Very unlike. He's a very shy, quiet guy normally.
Yeah. And it was a bad time to get animated in hindsight, wasn't it?
Mm. It was. Although I was with him at the time.
Yeah, I was too, yeah.
Drago. He's made of iron. That's always the risk with that stuff, isn't it?
Yeah. It's always potentially something that doesn't date well.
Mm.
Yeah, but like it could go the opposite way then as well though, couldn't it? And if it did go well, it would be, oh, that was a huge turning point when he roared the house down.
That's what they said at the commentaries at the time. That was a huge moment. It was, but I don't think it really has any lasting effect. That's very good. Did you get a lot of snow up there?
We did. We had great crack today. Kids were running around. We went out in sleds. Not sleds. I had a bodyboard and I stuck the two kids on it and set them down. your typical Instagram moments. How many families have you seen today with showcasing their family and the snowman in the background?
Mm.
Your typical Instagram post.
We got fuck all down here, so there's much of that.
Oh, really?
CJ Stander on the bed as what you call him, Peter Sheldon?
He's Paul the Sheldon? Character. Paul Sheldon, yeah. Strapped to the bed, his wife breaking his legs.
With the sledgehammer. That has to be the most horrific scene of any film.
Isn't it awful? Yeah.
I remember seeing that when I was like fucking 10 years of age, man.
I saw that. I was too young as well. That, Candyman, It, like
Jaws.
Jaws.
Yeah, but they're the four, I think, for me that are like, nah, shouldn't have seen that.
Too young.
The poor fella, and he lined her. She puts the plank and Oh, they really show it as well. Yeah. They show it.
It's his ankle. It's his ankles, isn't it? She smashes.
Yeah, but it's even a little bit above the ankle. She takes the ankle.
I haven't
end.
Seen that. So he's lying on the bed and he's strapped to the bed and it's just...
She gets a plank of wood and she puts it in between his legs. So in between his probably his knees, maybe just below his knees, in between his knees and his shins. And she takes a sledgehammer and she fucking smashes his legs, both of them, with a sledgehammer.
Wow.
To keep him there because she's obsessed with his writing and she wants him to be... She wants him to be to write her a book, isn't it? Or finish one of his books. So she wants him to play number 8 for Ireland. So she straps him to the bed. Breaks his legs.
Could happen.
Who else was doing what?
What was Peter O'Mahony doing in the garden?
He was going for a walk in the garden, but he was a bit upset because the frost was damaging his hostas.
What's a hosta?
Hosta is a type of plant, I assume.
You googled plants, did you?
I googled your typical plant. Typical
Limerick garden plants.
How was the rest of your week, lads? Jeremy, you're making some food, I've seen.
Yeah, my culinary expertise has gone through the roof since I've been off the beer for the month. So I got sent a load of CBD and I'm infusing it with butter in a slow cooker. And then I'm going to make a load of CBD-infused goodies afterwards.
Wow, so you crushed up the CBD plant.
Yeah.
And then put it in oil.
Ground it up and threw it into a slow cooker with some butter and a cup of water. And then you'll have butter that you can cook with.
Just leave it settle and then that goes into butter when it settles.
Going to leave it cool. No, I'm going to have to put it through the AeroPress, I'd say. Or you're supposed to run it through a cheesecloth, but that sounds too confusing. And I have an AeroPress, so I'm just going to run it through that. And that'll and let that cool and then into the fridge. And then you can put it on your toast if you want.
Oh, so this just calms you down, this CBD butter.
Yeah, well, it's I suppose there's loads of benefits of it. It's essentially the oil, like, you know, there's loads of benefits to using CBD oil that a lot of people talk about.
Mm. Stress levels. Saying my heart thing was a stress level, which could well have been.
Mm.
A few people have pointed that out to me. Good old stress.
Mm.
I could try this.
You could try it. Yeah, there's
lashed in.
There's a shop in Galway that's a dispensary, a CBD dispensary. It's fully legal. It's legit. It's above board. And you could buy all sorts of hemp infused oils. It's good for pain relief, good for sleeping, good for all of that stuff.
How have you found it being off the booze, Dermy?
Fantastic. My production levels were the exact same. My productivity was the same amount of productivity it was in December, though.
But you just feel better.
Just you feel great, yeah.
Man.
Must say though, you'd love an old drink though on the old Friday and Saturday evenings.
Yeah, I had 3 pints last night.
Did you?
From Finnegan's Bar and Restaurant.
Mm.
They deliver when you order food, they deliver pints as well. So I had 3 pints watching the match. It was great.
Yeah. That's great.
And then we had a gig afterwards.
Oh yeah, we did a gig last night.
Yeah. Wasn't live, unfortunately, to anyone that thinks it was. But a load of our Penguins got in, listened in and they were watching. We recorded a few weeks ago. And I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. It was the equivalent of not playing, of having retired from rugby. It was equivalent to you going back playing for Coleraine, I'd say, for me. It was the equivalent of not playing music for a year and then going, oh yeah, I have a gig there in the INEC. And you have to
Jeez,
play
I hope it went
songs.
Better than that did.
No, we were ropey, man. We were well, I was ropey as feck anyway. But people still seem to enjoy it, which is great. Anyway, we'll take a break, but let's get stuck into this match and a bit more rugger. Nice one. Okay, Munster versus Leinster. If you're a Munster fan, that was most likely bitterly disappointing as a result. It seemed like we were in prime position to get the win, but it just, we needed that scalp so much over Leinster that we, I think we were in desperation to get it. We thought we had it, but no, alas, they stole it at the end. As a neutral, before I get too emotionally involved in the whole thing, how did you find it, Trimby?
As a neutral, I thought Leinster are a little bit off the boil. I thought they had periods where they looked like the Leinster of old, and their attack play and phase play just looked fluid. And it was probably, I'd say, between after that initial bit of Munster pressure, towards the end of the first half, really 20 minutes, 25 minutes of Leinster looking good. But crucially, they had nothing to show for it. And then I know we're ultimately eventually going to talk about that swing of penalties just before halftime, and then JJ missing that penalty that started second half. But that was everything, because Munster did enough to get ahead. And I think if they had have got that, if JJ had got that penalty before halftime, Johnny wouldn't have got his penalty up the other end. And then we're looking at 13-3 instead of 10-6. And that's a game changer, I think. Go, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree. It was a huge, huge moment. And they were unlucky, obviously, to get that off the post and then to come back and get a penalty because of Rhys Marshall slipping. And then, as you said, Leinster, when they did get into those patterns, they were quite good. They were making yards. Larmer and Ringrose, their footwork, I think it was both of those got them into the position for that penalty that Sexton scored at halftime, with just ducking and diving under tackles, which I think that was, those little things were making the difference. I thought all in all it was a lot of positives, right? Andy Farrell must be coming out of that going brilliant. No huge injuries. Johnny Sexton looks like a little bit of a hamstring. I'm guarantee he'll be fine. Peter Mandy came off, guarantee he'll be fine. And just two teams with loads of the best players in the country going head to head, and plenty of positives to take from it. So I think all in all, it'll be good for our rugby. Leinster, yeah, they have been off form of late. We've said that, I think, since the Champions Cup games in the middle of December. They haven't been really at their strongest, and obviously losing to Connacht, but still managed to come out of that with a win. And when they probably shouldn't, a lot of people would say, but then when I watched it back again today, and as you're saying, a lot of those long phase of possession they had when they looked like Leinster of old, fuck, they looked impressive for those moments. So yeah, a lot of positives. Larmer Ringrose back, as I said. I know the Larmer dropped a few high balls, right? I think he dropped two or three in the first half, but they were really good kicks from Murray and
yeah,
really
I don't think you'd hold too much against them with that, because definitely at least one or two. Earlsy had his hand right up in the breadbasket, so Earlsy was just trying to disrupt it rather than gather it himself. And I don't think you'd hold that against Larmer too much.
No, they're perfectly executed the way you want a box kick executed. They were off quick ball. Munster had thrown a few varieties of play beforehand, so it wasn't as obvious what they were doing, and a good chase line. But outside of that, his footwork was unbelievable. He put those two really good grubbers through, which I thought were two massive parts of the game. Both of them ended up in 5 metre scrums for Leinster. And his try was brilliant finishing. I thought Ringrose looked really good. I thought Henshaw was unbelievable. A lot of the talking into the game was Damien Delende, how good he's been, how good he still could be, even, stepping up another gear. He could be the difference between the two teams. And for Henshaw to go out and outplay him, I was so impressed.
I think they were both incredible. I don't think Henshaw was any better than him. I think they were just both brilliant.
Oh, I just thought the moments Henshaw had, he had four or five carries that I think he really, really inspired Leinster yesterday, got him well over the game line, and was just looked like a man possessed. Not taking anything from Dale Ende, I thought he did a good game, yeah. But I just thought the knock-on effect of what Henshaw was doing, showing that, when Munster got into the game, it was like a lot of the talk was talking up the centres and how this was the new potency that Munster had to the attack, and then he was kind of outplaying them for a good bit of it.
I thought De Allende was class. I thought he was brilliant though. Defensively, he gets himself around the pitch, makes so many big hits, and he's so physical with ball in hand as well. He just wriggles and he just wriggles and twists and turns and just carries incredibly well. Mm. I thought De Allende was incredible too. That they were both brilliant. I think it was more remarkable how good Ringrose was, considering he hasn't played. And then obviously Larmer, as you say, he's played one game, but looked pretty sharp. And those the high ball thing, you know, he will be a little bit disappointed with that. But I think that's probably just a little bit of rustiness coming back into it. A lot of guys putting their hands up. I thought, as you say, I thought Munster were the best team. I thought they were, by a good bit, I thought they were the best team for long periods in the game, but they didn't put the game to bed. And I think it was crucial and it was criminal. And I think in the second half, they didn't play like Leinster would have played in the past. Like they just didn't put the game out of sight whenever it deserved to be put to bed. And they paid the price for it, because Leinster were just... they're almost like a golfer who's kind of just struggling a little bit. They just know how to scramble and they know how to put themselves into a position where maybe they can get something out of the game. And that maybe becomes more significant because they've got a mental edge over Munster. That maybe becomes a probably. And they just get their one chance and that's all they need. And they executed. Hugo Keenum was really good as well. Just picked up that little grubber from Ringrose and then just linked it on. It was a shame from a Munster's point of view, but I think Munster will still be massively upbeat after that game, despite them all being in bad form on the snow day. They were, I think they can take a lot of credit from that. They're so much closer. They were better than Leinster, and they just need to learn how to win. Now, I know that's still a big step, but I think whenever it comes to a final, they might have. They've took massive strides. Leinster were head and shoulders better than them in the semi-final last year and for long periods over the last few seasons. And I think Munster have narrowed the gap. I think it's probably a lot of it's Leinster have kind of took, they don't look as fluid. Like, I know they had that period, but like usually it's 80 minutes of that. They had 20 minutes of it at the end of the first half. And then they had a bit of magic really to score the try. But I think Leinster aren't quite as smooth with their phase play and as kind of as accurate as they have been in the past. And I think Munster just they're way better and way closer to Leinster than maybe they probably feel a bit disheartened, but I think they're a lot closer than they probably feel at the minute.
Yeah. Maybe. I mean, it's hard to tell really, isn't it? I think I don't think they should be disheartened too much, and they should take confidence in the fact that they really should have won that game. But at the same time, it's so frustrating, I'm sure, to have come away without winning it. Like, the unbelievable first 10 minutes, I controlled everything, showed loads of variety, earned a good penalty and scored a great try. There were, you know, Murray made a little dart off the back of a line out. And you're thinking 10 minutes in, 10-0 up, great start. They didn't score for the rest of the game. That's 70 minutes without scoring a point. And
they tried to manage the game rather than just going after it.
And the discipline was poor, you know, giving away soft penalties. And obviously that moment just before halftime with the kick was unfortunate, because 13-3 would have been a big score to go in at halftime. Then a couple of funny incidents. Like the incident of JJ missed that kick in front of the post. I put this into the Facebook group earlier on, where he missed the kick in front. Like they that was outrageous. I watched it back this morning. So they get a penalty 7 yards out, right in front of the posts, and like not to the right of the post, directly in between the posts, slightly more to the right of the right post than the left, but still in front of the posts, 7 yards out. I mean, if you get a penalty in that position, you don't move the ball. You take it from 7 yards out and you kick it, right? Because you can't miss. And then where does JJ get to take the penalty from? About 7 or 8 yards to the right of the post and back of the 22. And I just cannot get over the fact that the only reason I can think that it was that Noam was saying that was that Peter was injured at the time, because the Munster coaches were definitely getting that onto the field. This is the wrong position for the kick. and maybe Andy Brace wasn't able to talk to he kind of tends to refuse to talk to any other player than the captain. So Peter's down injured, and it's the only thing I can think of how that someone would make that kind of mistake, because you'd seen earlier on Leinster got a penalty and they had a kick at goal, and whoever was in Andy Brace's ear, it wasn't Joy Neville, it was a male voice, who's saying, it's back on the 10-meter line there. Yeah, back right there. Yeah, just another yard to your left. Tell him exactly where the penalty was from. So there was that available, and it wasn't used. I know JJ probably still could have kicked that, but I just think that was a massive mistake and so unheard of. Then you had the line out for the try that was clearly crooked for the Leinster try. It was clearly a crooked line out that Conor Murray is calling the touch judge and the ref, saying this is a crooked throw. And they don't go back and check it, which I thought was weird. That you do, when is a try winning or match winning try that they don't go back and check it? I can't really excuse that.
Yeah, yeah, I know. I didn't notice the penalty, and the throw. Yeah, looked a bit crooked. It's yeah, I know, and. Yeah, the Munster were obviously pretty pissed off with Tyburn kind of accepting his man of the match, and you know, mentioning it there, but they shouldn't have been anywhere near. Well, JJ should have got that penalty anyway, and it's so, I feel for him, because only a few weeks ago he's the hero kicking. How many penalties are it? Did he
nine
kick?
Nine against
nine Claremont, from yeah. nine, yeah, and you know, and he's lauded, and it's just so. Difficult, like the one that hit the post was a tricky one, so he's just really missed one that he should have got, and but it's a significant one, it's a big one, and
yeah, no, you can't miss kicks like that.
Yeah, that's gotten for him.
I thought Shane Daly was really good for Munster as well. He was really impressive. Connor had a good game, got around the pitch.
Connor was brilliant.
Ty Byrne again. Getting a few turnovers.
He's starting the Six Nations, will he, Tig?
Okay, well, let's do that conversation now. So what Andy Farrell come out of that going, I had a lot of positives, as I said. I still don't see a lot of changes happening in his starting 15. I think Keane Healy, probably Rob Herring and Porter. Porter was pretty immense last night. Played a full 80 minutes, which was unheard of for a front row. Sean Cronin, still completely out of the loop, like, isn't he, when it comes to Ireland?
Yeah, it's he's too athletic to be a hooker for a kind of set piece, you know.
So it's just strange.
It's just one of those things that has always gone against him. He is such an athlete, and he's so good in the loose, but I don't know if his set piece is that bad. I assume that's the reputation that he's got, or maybe he's maybe not as good kind of in the tight or kind of physical tight exchange, but it's so tough on him because he adds so much elsewhere.
Yeah, it doesn't look like he's gonna get a little look in. So you're talking Keane Healy, Herring and Porter, James Ryan and Hendy. I still think Ty Byrne may be best at Ireland as a six. When you give me the option either having Hendy or James Ryan or Tyke Byrne in the second row, Henderson on his day, such a big bruiser, ball carrier, adds
He's injured now, isn't he?
Is he going to be out? Yeah,
not sure.
Okay, if he's not, then 100% Tyke Byrne. Get me wrong. Also off the bench if Hendy was fit. Back row then. Doris O'Mahony, CJ, can you argue that?
No, that picks itself at the minute, I think. And it's mad how that does pick itself, because Pete was fighting for his life not that long ago, and he's come through. He's been incredible recently. And whenever you consider how good Josh has been and how good Will Connors has been, Pete still puts his hand up there. He's done unbelievably well. Weirdly, I thought Keelan Doris had just a little bit of an off night.
I thought so too, yeah.
And no one said that. He literally hasn't put a foot wrong his whole career. He's just always been incredible, like almost boringly consistent. People don't even mention him anymore because he's usually one of the best players on the pitch. And it's such a typical narrative. But like the penalty he gave away, the penalty that JJ missed, he got caught on the wrong side, and he got up and got in the way, and he just looked
that was like weird.
It was really weird. Usually so streetwise, so switched on, and he just looked not himself.
Yeah. That's fair enough, but I think he'll start.
Yeah, he will. He will, yeah.
Luke McGrath, I thought, was absolutely brilliant last night.
He was, yeah.
He's, when they brought Gibson Park on and they stuck him on the wing, you kind of felt, oh, interesting now, where Luke McGrath is obviously going to play the full 80 and different dynamic, because you always expect Gibson Park to come on and up the tempo or something. So I was kind of looking at that going, oh, I wonder what Leinster were going to do here, because they're losing that part of their game plan. But it was Luke McGrath that injected the bit of energy. He took that quick tap, made a big break himself off a line-out. And it's funny, in the commentary, like, he, for some reason, they were obviously talking about something else. They didn't really draw attention to it too much. But they were two of the biggest yards made in the entire game, and kind of drove Leinster on to getting that score, and just huge turning points. And I thought he was just zipping around the place.
Yeah, there's something Rog said actually during the week, which kind of stuck with me, and I saw it in Luke last night. He looks like a guy who maybe almost regrets being like nearly too respectful or something whenever he got his chance, like as if it's Murray's position.
Yeah,
I'll see what I can do, but it's Murray's position, and I'll try and be maybe, you know, second choice, or get some opportunities whenever he's not available, or whatever it is. But Roger was kind of suggesting that he was too respectful, and he wouldn't have that mindset now. And you can see a marked difference. He just looks like he's out to make a point. I think that's what you're getting at. And then maybe Gibson Park getting capped in the autumn just made him just kind of go, right, you know, I've kind of had enough of this. It's now or never. Time to start kind of expressing myself, or backing myself, or just behaving in a way that I didn't get on in the past.
I agree.
I deserve to be here. Yeah. Because he was brilliant.
Brilliant. Andy Dunn brought it up on News Talk the other day on Off the Ball. Love Andy Dunn. God, he's so good. We should get him on again. And he went hard at Connor. He was questioning Connor's, he was slowing down the ball for Ireland and Munster over the last few years, maybe playing too much to the game plan and sticking to it and not playing outside of it. And it was an interesting conversation, really interesting. And when Rog, I think that's what they brought Rog on, he was talking about that as well, and how in France, obviously, you have someone like Dupont, who's in the French style rugby, that they're the kind of guys, the scrum halves are the kind of guys who drive the pace and control the game, as opposed to the out halves who have in Ireland. And it's a very, very interesting conversation. I think Connor maybe has taken that under consideration, because he's definitely started making little breaks and having a go again. He started to bring that back into his game, because we all know he can do it. And it's so important that he does, because you see what Luke can do.
But there's so many more options around Connor now. There's everybody else is so much more lively. Mm. And I think their forwards just look like they're offering themselves. Like, Jean Klein, I thought he played really well actually as well, and he got more involved than you would have seen him in the past. The forwards have this really nice shape where they have two forwards off 9 or off 10, and they hit the first one, and then it's slow, almost like it looks like they're slowing things down, then they tip it onto the second one, then he's the one who feeds the backs out the back. And Murray's obviously got, they've given a lot more thought to the shape around him. So that kind of suits him. He's got more options, which means there's more threat, which means there's more opportunity for him. But that little play for Munster is another sign of Larkin and his creativity and what they're bringing. We didn't see it in the second half at all. We saw it for the first 15, 20 minutes of the game, and then that was kind of it.
Yeah, that would worry me. When they brought Craig Casey on, then they decided to kick box kicks, which is obviously a tactic, and they're bringing him on to telling him to do it, because that's not the kind of player he is. So that was frustrating when you're now they're maybe trying to force an error because they were getting a return off of, but the difference was in the first 20 minutes.
It does make sense though, because they're trying to, when it gets to like 60, 70 minutes, they're at that stage, they're trying to manage the win, but managing the game from 40 minutes doesn't work. They're more guilty.
It makes sense when you're doing it right, but when you're doing it with one chaser, it doesn't work. When you're doing a slow ball, one chaser.
They forced a few errors out of what's his name? Larmer.
Yeah, but that was with, to be fair, that was with double chasers. That's with Urzi and JJ. It was always with one or two chasers and then with even a follow-up. Whereas if you watch Craig Casey's four kicks, there was one chaser. There was no, you know, usually of the out half who's closing in as well, the other side of the ruck. There was none of that. They were a little bit too far. There was no one under pressure. And I think that's where the difference is. If you're going to do it, you got to do it right. Anyway, we digress. I think back to the forwards thing, I was going to say O'Connell's influence on that with the options off 9 and 10, I think is going to be huge. I can't wait to see that. Even like working with the boys under 18s with him for the lockdown number 2 there from September to November, he came down and did a good bit of work with the ball carrying off 9s and 10s, and I found it really interesting. I think that's going to be a huge strength of his, getting lads to focus on one or two little things that'll make them way better ball carriers. Give the 9, as you're saying, 3 or 4 options off every play, whether it's a little soft ball on his right or left shoulder, or a wide pass, or out the back pass, or even chip kicks or box kicks. I think he's going to be excellent at that. And I think that's something we've missed for a long time.
Yeah, I don't think it'll happen straight away. I think it'll take a while for that to come into effect. I think we've seen how long it's took for Munster to start to play that style of rugby. And O'Connell, I know you have a more intense period, obviously, when guys are in camp in the bubble. Mm. But we might not see it this Six Nations.
Mm. Rest of our team, so I'm going with Murray and Sexton. With McGrath to come off the bench, and I'm going with Carty as sub out half. I know he didn't play today. I don't know why he didn't play today, but I thought if you take him in comparison to how he controlled the Connacht win against Leinster, I know that was against a weakened Leinster team, but he found grass so much in that game with those long drill kicks that we talked about at the time, where he was putting the back three under severe pressure, and it was very hard with a low trajectory to see where the ball was going to bounce, and he was finding so much grass, and I think Munster could have done massively with that, and I think that was probably the difference. I'd love to see him getting another shot and getting him back in the mix, giving him that confidence by picking him on the bench, even though, you know, he's not starting. I still think it will do a lot for him, because, you know, it's either him or Billy Burns at this point, isn't it?
I think I'd probably Ross Byrne. Probably go Billy Burns.
Would you?
Yeah, I think it's a bit of a, it's 50-50. Well, I think I would go Billy Burns. Just, he does all that stuff. I think he brings that level of composure, but he can also up the pace. And if he comes on early for Sexton, as could very well be the case, then I think he can manage a game quite well as well. For me, I'd probably go Billy Burns. It's you're in no bad shape though if you go Cardi.
Hmm. And then center.
And Sexton, it's funny how so Sexton is 100% assert. Anybody who's saying otherwise is wrong. And the perfect example of Sexton managing a game and driving his team was getting the penalty just before halftime on their 22. Anybody else might maybe put that out or put it, you know, on the 10-meter line, just throw the line out in and then put it out. But he goes long with that penalty, gets the line out, and just manages the play, and just manages his way to get a penalty, slots it. That's leadership, and that's Johnny Sexton, that's experience.
Hmm. One thing that annoyed me in the game last night was the scrums were taking so long to... Did you notice that, to play?
No,
the first scrum took 3 minutes, over 3 minutes to play, and then every couple after that was... You know when you get the whistle blown for a scrum, and then remember if you watch a game from like 5 or 6 years ago, the scrum happens within 10-20 seconds from this whistle being blown.
It used to be like everyone used to just like run in and just go.
Scrum now, but like before anyone even considers binding now, it's 30-40 seconds before anyone stands up and gets ready, and that. So then it's another 30 seconds. No scrum is under a minute. Every scrum is either a minute 30. Some are going up into two and a half, 3 minutes. And now that's even, okay, they're being reset once or twice. But I reckon, I was trying to tot it up this morning, I reckon that 15 minutes of that game last night was taken up And there wasn't a huge amount of scrums. It's not like there was a scrum every 10 minutes, which has happened in the past. The actual scrums were fine, but it was just taken. I think we've let that creep into the game now, where players are taking their time and it's just
going through their routine
thing.
And doing all that.
Yeah, because it's not so much the refs. I think the ref is going, no, I've blown that up or slowing it down. Most of them were just kept being carried out perfectly.
Yeah, they're always
massively taken out of the game. Then
they're always fannying around. They're always like just making sure they get their bind correct and their shoulder just latched perfectly into the guy's armpit. And no one else gives a crap what you guys are doing. No one could care less. Get the ball to the backs, please, lads.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Yeah, just pick and go if you want, as long as you pass it or make a few yards. But, oh, it was going mental watching.
Anyway, centres.
Centres, Henshaw, Ringrose, done in the bag.
Yeah.
Has to be. And wingers, here's an interesting one. I think we're both going to go with Hugo Keenan fullback, right?
Yeah, fine, yeah.
Yeah. Stockdale, let's say he's fit. Then you've probably, like Conway hasn't played in a while, you're probably not going to see... He might get into the squad, but I'd be surprised if he starts. So it's between...
James Lewis fit, but hasn't played.
Yeah. Is he fit? I think apparently. He was out this weekend.
And Dave Carney had a bit of a hamstring, apparently, Cullen said. So yeah. But he's not far off either. He'll be fit as well. And he's been going well, but he's not going to. Yeah.
So it's James Lowe, Keith Earls, Jacob Stockdale, and now Jordan Lemoore, who really put his hand up for me last night. I still think it'll be... Earlsey and Stockdale.
I agree, yeah. Earlsey and Larm, Jacob.
With Larmer on the bench.
Yeah.
That fair.
Yeah, it's fine.
Fair impact. It's mm-hmm. Exciting to see him back. Really am. I think get him on the field with 25 minutes to go in a Six Nations game, and hopefully dry day, let him rip. A few tired bodies. It's so important to have a guy like that coming on these days, coming off the bench and hopefully getting some ball in his hand. I think that's it, lads.
That's us.
That's our team.
Jeez, cool. It was easy picked, actually, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was, actually, wasn't it? There's very few ones you'd be arguing with. All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be back with part three, and we've got a lovely guest who's coming on to defend himself in part three. Bottles and Penguins is an independent production. And what I mean by that is...
It may sound like we don't know what we're talking about. You might even think Barry's hardly even played professional rugby and Dermy likes hurling. We want you to think that. It takes a lot of preparation to sound this unprepared.
We work very, very hard at what we do. And we want to make this show the best podcast in the world. For just $5 a month, you can help us do that.
Go to patreon.com/potholesandpenguins and you can help me make these two fools look and sound even better than I already am making them look.
Now, this week, rather than focusing on one Energy All-Ireland League team, we are delighted to say that we are joined by Corcon's top try scorer of all time, a man who's gotten up at 6 o'clock in the morning in Sydney, Australia, to join us and defend himself for... being described as the most annoying rugby player to ever play AIL rugby by Dennis Foggs and maybe us over the last few weeks. Cronan Healy, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, lads. And I think we can add Australia in there as well now at this stage.
Congratulations.
Yeah. I'm well on my way to getting an Oscar at this stage.
I didn't realise how just mentioning your name would land, like, or not even mentioning your name, just describing you, because we had Foggs on a couple of weeks ago, and then Barry put me on the spot and was like, what's your memories of Cork Con? And I was there was this winger, bald fella, socks down, like real guy, kind of look, GA, kind of look, socks down around his ankles, and everybody's like, I know exactly.
Yeah. It clicks. The penny dropped. I must say I did have that innate ability to get underneath people's skins.
Yeah, well, did you listen to the episode with Foggs? Because we got a message off a few of your mates going, you need to get this man here to defend himself, because Foggs, so what did he say you did? You placed the ball on the post.
yeah. We were playing Clonakilty in the Charity Cup, and it was just one of those games. I got an interception sort of a thing, and for some reason it was always at the back of my mind, oh, I always want to score by placing the ball against the post. But like back in those days, it was never really a done thing. And like, I was never aware of this sort of against the base of the post. So then, you know, I had probably 10 seconds to think about it as I was running from halfway line. And like the whole sort of image of my head was a lot better than the reality. And so then when I eventually got to the post, I just clattered it against the top of the post, and everybody just stopped and was sort of, because not many people followed me because it was an interception. People just went back to the for the restart, and everybody turned around and they were like, what happened? And the ref there is just going, knock on, scrum. So it was a bit embarrassing.
So you thought they're gonna love this. The crowd's gonna go mad.
I had the images of telling the story up against the bar after the game and everything.
So he didn't give the try. I thought he'd actually give him the try.
He gave a knock on.
Did you try?
You're like the George Best of the All Ireland League. So like, didn't he have this? He always wanted to dribble the ball around the goalkeeper and then head the ball over the line.
Yeah,
and he never got to complete his vision, but you did.
Yeah, I did. Hopefully without a drink problem though on my side, if you're comparing me to George Best.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, look, I have a very a lot of memories playing against you. I'm not sure what your memories of me are. First time I ever played against you, I dislocated my shoulder trying to tackle you down in Corcon, and it was trying to hold on to you despite, you know, you of being small stature, incredibly strong and powerful and unbelievable feat. What was take us back to your early days. Was it Con from underage for you, or how did you
No, I started in Highfield. So like, I suppose the rugby fraternity in Cork is very small. So there's an overlap with everybody. Like if you equate the school system in Cork to Limerick, there's only two real rugby playing schools in Cork, while you have a number three or four up in Limerick. So a lot smaller for the size of it. So you have a crossover with everybody. So I started in Highfield, and people that would have been on my team would have been Conor Quaid. Not too sure if you remember mm-hmm. Conor Quaid. Of course, so yeah. I started with Quaidy, played up to under 12s, then went to Prez. Was in Prez then with Conrad. So I sort of grew up with Conrad. I would have played GA with Conrad at underage with our divisional side. So I knew Conrad for years, and then we grew up in Prez playing rugby together. After Prez, then I went to, I repeated my leaving cert and did a year playing with Highfield. I went back to Highfield and played a year with them in the AIL and under 20s. Then I have a bit of a journeyman now. How long do we have? After that, I went to Sundays Well, I went to UCC first for my first year in uni. Did a year there, then did 2 years with Sundays Well after that. And then I went to Con after that, and then stayed with Con. So obviously got a lot of money out of all the transfers. a bit of a journeyman, but yeah, very enjoyable to all those different clubs.
Ah, well, I think everyone associates you with Con, and I think that was a beautiful era of AIL rugby as well. Like when, 2002 or 2003 was it when you would have signed for Con?
Yeah.
And then you left in 2011, was it? You were moved to Australia?
2010. So I came over here, actually. It's my 10-year anniversary is tomorrow.
Oh, cool. And did you play rugby over there when you went?
Yeah, so I played Shoot Shield the first year I came over with Ranwick. And didn't really enjoy it. And I went traveling a bit, so it was a bit of in and out. And then once I came back from that, I just played Kentwell Rugby. So that's sort of one layer below Shoot Shield. But there's a big bridge between what Shoot Shield would be offering v what Kentwell Cup would be offering. So played with Kentwell, managed to get onto the New South Wales team, and where you play Queensland and the Australian Army. You have those type of games. So I did that for a few years. And actually still playing now with my local side in Bondi.
Oh, God.
Yeah, and people still hate me. Instead of being the small annoying person, I'm now the old annoying person.
That's a far cry from an AIL match. And where did you say that one was? Clonakilty was there across Avon.
Yeah.
Well, take us back to some of your fondest memories of the AIL yet then, Wiccan, because you're a pretty successful team. But what are your standout memories?
So the memory that definitely stands out in my head, and I made reference to Conrad there, was we had a final against St. Mary's a week or two after that, and it got delayed for another week or two and post that as well. And we played Mary's in the final, and Mary's would have had people like Sexton playing and the likes of that. I think Kieran Potts would have been another player. Mm. So we played him in that final and we won it well, but I think just the whole emotion that surrounded that game, obviously with the passing of Conrad and everything, and as I was saying there, with Cork rugby being very, very small, everybody had a material touch point with Conrad. So it touched everybody, even if you were new to the club, it touched everybody dramatically. So I think that's probably the one that stands out most for me. And I, as you alluded to there, there was a fair few successful years. We did the double one year, and again, that stands out in your head. But in terms of a memory of AIL rugby, I think playing the games up in Kuna and Thoman Park against Shannon, just because their supporters get so involved in the games. And equally, I'm somebody who loves to get involved with the supporters as well. So like thinking back, they're definitely the games that stand out over that time. It was
getting abused up in Kuna.
Yeah, 100%. But it was like good banter. You'd have a pint and people shake your hand in the bar afterwards and buy you a pint. Like, they're the type of memories you can never create again.
And what about the lads you played with then? Would you keep in touch with them much, or if you're ever home, would you?
We have a WhatsApp group from that double winning team. We're on that, and one of the guys, Evan Ryan, was trying to arrange a get together and meet up just around the start of COVID.
You're like, in Australia, please in Australia.
I was hoping they were going to fly me home. This is fast and everything. we have that communication and that touch point with everybody. But as I said, Cork being so small, when you go back for Christmas, everybody's home from Dublin and the likes, and you bump into everybody all over again.
But that team is like yourself and Simon Zeebo on the wing. Evan, Richie, as you said, Evan, Richie Lane. We were talking beforehand about Richie Lane. You don't see rugby players like Richie Lane very often anymore, do you? Like, his legs are like about 5 foot long, and then short,
destined for the catwalk.
great character. Then you've Darragh Lyons, you've Jeremy Manning,
Frank Hogan,
Peter O'Mahony, Stephen Archer, Ian Nagle, Brian Hayes. An unbelievable team he had.
Yeah, fairly stacked. And I remember it was very much the focus of the conversations around that time was Mary's very much committed to this sort of just playing their local lads, not really bringing back their development players. So it was a bit of a theme of that final in terms of how we had six or seven development players. But I think that was just the nature of the league at that time, where we had that back and forth, where there was a level of trust within the Munster side to send their players back into Conn, and Conn very much took them underneath their wing in terms of bringing them into the identity that they created. So it wasn't like we were bringing back all these superstars. They were very much added value in terms of what we built as a club and what we built as players.
Yeah. I like it was a great era for that. There was players that were there was a big connection between the clubs and the provinces. Well, I can only speak for Munster, and I felt there was. It was always, you know, if I wasn't playing for Munster on a weekend or if I was on the bench, I'd always get a game of Bowes, and it was pretty seamless to slot in. How did you feel when you left? And did you feel like there's been a lot of talks of that connection has kind of gone, you know, for a man who's played more AL rugby than most. What are your thoughts on it now?
I must say, I've lost touch with what the environment is like now. So I can only tell in terms of what I see, like the con team lining out week to week and the development players coming back. So it doesn't look like it's lost that touch point and that involvement from the professional team into the amateur side. From my own personal perspective, I'd love to see them embrace it a lot more. I'm not too sure what that actually looks like. There's obviously better people out there that need to decide on what that actually looks like. But I always felt that the AIL was never given the credibility and the respect of where it sat in terms of developing these players. And, you know, I watch your show an awful lot, and I very much get the team from the older players, how they respect the learnings they got out of the AIL and what that sort of rugby, how that shaped them. But whether that's still there now in terms of the newer players, whether they have that same sort of essence about what sort of rugby player they are now. But I think that could be done a bit better in terms of integrating the AIL as part of, not too sure if it replaces this A league that they have, the B&I Cup, I think it's called. Mm. But I definitely think that there's a position there for the AIL to have a more material place within that bridge from amateur to professional.
Yeah, no, I think you agree. I think a lot of players, we had Benny Healy on a few weeks ago, and he talked about playing a number of games from Gary Owen, and that was I thought that was encouraging. And you know, the more these guys get up against seasoned guys that have been playing the game a long time, when these young fellas come out of school or you know, even players that develop late. Like, I remember you coming into Munster squad a good few times when you were probably, you know, mid-20s, were you, at that time? And I think Kidney was brilliant.
Yeah, I'd say 24, 25.
Yeah, when you hadn't come through the usual pathway, ranks. Yeah. Yeah, the pathway. And I think James Collum was someone who was similar. James had brought in at 24, 25. We all know how successful he went on. You know, and James and yourself, you learned how to win games of rugby by playing at the top level in your club and playing week in, week out. And I think there's so much to be said for that. I mean, is that how you felt when you know, did you feel like, now I've been finally given an opportunity? Was it Decky that brought you in then?
No, it was actually Bix, Brian Hickey.
Yeah.
I sort of feel that you alluded to there in terms of being on the conveyor belt at an early age. And that very much is the system. That's very much where the material numbers of players that make it to the professional game come from. And it's obviously, they need to focus on that. But I definitely feel that sort of late developer pathway just isn't there. They obviously have that sort of, that scheme where they bring people in to train with the professional sides, you know, during the Six Nation windows, so you get that exposure, and you when you're in that late developer sort of token. But I definitely think they could do it better. I always felt it was sort of tokenism. It plumossed the clubs when they were pushing players, but I never thought that there was a real commitment to it. That was just my own personal.
That's interesting. It's interesting.
And you know, you made reference there in terms of the exposure that you get within the AIL. And one of the things that sort of stands out to me is it Duncan Stewart, I think was the name of an Ulster player. Not too sure. I think he was in the squad of the team that won the Heineken Cup, and he was playing with Malone. It's one of the standout memories I have of the AIL was he was just a brute of a man. Took no prisoners. And I remember just playing against them up in Malone, and he'd send you in the next week. just a brood of a man. It really stands out to me.
Yeah. Oh, look, was that one of your favourite clashes? Like, did you ever actually get yourself in any trouble on the field by your cheeky ways?
Thankfully, I have 14 snaps. Other players. albeit, you know, like you made reference of being a most hated man in Ireland, but you have to think of my teammates. They had to play with me on Tuesday and Thursdays as well, so they hated me even more.
You wear it well. I remember actually Bose, you beat Bose in the semi-final of the AAL in 2006 or 7, I think it was actually, and you scored an intercept try in the last minute of the game, and it was our one chance as a club to finally get to an AAL final, and last minute for you to score.
Yeah, we definitely didn't. Oh. We didn't deserve it.
Yeah, you're still hated in Bose anyway.
Fergal Lawler was the 10.
Yeah, I think Edwin Torrey actually threw the pass.
Yeah.
Because
it was actually, yeah.
Kidney brought him into training with Munster on the Monday because I think he needed a bit of a pep up in his step. So that was sound of him. But look, thanks a million for coming on, man. I think you've cleared it up.
He's great. Telling everyone we'll be changing your reputation in Ireland. Great.
Too late, I think.
Are you happily settled in Australia, or have you any plans to come home?
No, happy here. Have a baby due this day week.
Oh wow!
So the first baby boy due. So it's going to be a complete change of lifestyle. I think I've got it into the oldest dad's club anyway. But yeah,
I look forward to that kid's first day at mini rugby. Just shave the kid's head, pull the socks down.
I'm going to be that dad on the sideline.
well, best of luck for the next week, man. That's unbelievable. A great time for you in your life.
Yeah, congratulations.
A massive congrats. Yeah. Cheers. So look. Yeah, look, stay in touch. If your name, I'm sure, will crop up more and more on this show when we talk about AAL in part 3. So,
hopefully in better terms.
Exactly, yeah. Look, all the best next week, and thanks a million for joining us. Cheers. I really appreciate
cheers,
it, man.
Cheers, Jonah. Cheers, lads. Bye-bye.
Okay, welcome back. Now, Facebook group, off the charts this week. I couldn't keep up with it. It was doing stuff to my heart. So I was afraid.
Facebook put you in hospital this week.
But I tried to get involved this morning, and I got called a princess by someone.
Princess.
Princess.
Yeah. And then I bit her lemon, so I had to congratulate.
I got a lot of abuse. For my score prediction, I was 1 point off. I got the try score wrong, to be fair.
What's the story? The main overriding subject across all the Facebook correspondence this week has been Liam Toland. What is going on there? And why do people despise Liam Toland?
I think it's that thing of commentators. commentators that if you either hate them or love them, most of them, right? There's always a little bit of a split on them. I don't see it with Liam Toland. I know him and he's very sound, very, very sound. Just a nice fella. And he played for Leinster, but he's from Limerick.
Okay.
So also played for Munster, I think, early days, but most of his career with Leinster. And people, I'd say, maybe feel he's a little bit biased towards them. Maybe subconsciously, as I don't think it's he intends on doing it. And yeah, I think it's a bit harsh. He says, what do you think, Jimmy?
It's hard for commentators. So if you're out with a group of lads, like anybody who talks as much as commentators talk, everybody hates them. So if you are a commentator and you literally have to commentate on the game 24/7. And by the way, Ryan Nugent commentated in the Connacht game with no co-coms earlier on today. If you saw that, it's literally him by himself.
That's hard.
Yeah, tricky. But it's tricky enough
at the best of times. And you have to say a lot. So like that's why people don't talk that much, because you don't always have that much interesting stuff to say. And if you always have to talk, you're going to say some things that are a bit boring and maybe annoying.
He says jeekist, yeah. Which is something you haven't heard since the early 90s.
I haven't heard jeekist. That's died out up north.
Jeekist, he did very well there, didn't he? I think my granny used to say jeekist. That's the only thing I can compare it to.
Last thing granny ever said.
Jeekist. Where's my purple dildo?
Engraved in her tombstone.
Barry, come close. Tell Liam Dolan to pass the baton on to the next generation. Jeekist. Okay, granny. Will do.
I got to take it from here, so maybe this is trying to pass back to me. Jeekist. I'm going to use that from now on. Other than that, he's grand.
He's great. Tolan's actually, I think he's really, really good. He is genuinely really good. He's very technical. He misses nothing. He's very, very good.
Misses nothing. That's an important one. Because it's hard thing to do to watch a game.
People just don't like commentators. That's just the way it is. Like even Robbo, we love Robbo. Robbo says he would be getting abuse from Munster supporters all the time.
People abusing him on Twitter there a couple of weeks ago. Which was look, it's not needed. What was I going to say?
Oh no, it is. It's encouraged, but keep it up. It just keeps things fresh in the group.
That's true. They're going to hate us for this. The one lad now I have to admire in our Facebook group, Luke Hanley, put in a photo of David Brent from The Office, Ricky Gervais, the episode where he goes on a blind date, and he
I just brought it up here.
He meets this blind date in the pub, and when he sees her, he looks into the camera and just goes, "Oh, for fuck's sake.
Oh, for fuck's sake."
And Luke has superimposed Liam Tolan's face onto the lady's face. And it's clearly, he's put it up 22 hours ago, so that was at the time of the Munster Leinster match. So it must have been just at the start when Liam Tolan first said his first words, and he's just gone, "Oh, for fuck's sake, Liam Tolan." Which we very much encourage to keep them coming. That was it. Other than that, it was loads of random penguin stuff and alien stuff. And we're due a big alien discussion.
Yeah, was there not supposed to be something coming out there from the Pentagon? Or
yeah, there was a good few things during the week now that I can talk about maybe during the week in our weekly pothole perhaps. All right, that's loads. That's plenty. Thank you very much for listening. Thanks for all our Patreons on our Facebook group. And thanks for Cronin Healy coming on. And have a great weekend. And have Connacht lost to the Ospreys. We didn't see it.
I saw most of that game.
It was on when I was getting the kids ready. So I didn't see it. But
it doesn't only having one commentator with no cool comms, it doesn't help the showcase of that Connacht game. It just makes it seem more bleak and barren. Yeah.
And either does this roundup of it, to be honest. That's the way, that's our brand. Anyway, unlucky, and party on.
Party on.
Party on.